Hey, this is Jim McDonald. Welcome to episode 195 of the PowerCast. This episode was recorded back in February with the guys from MisFit Athletics. That's Seth, Drew, and Ted. But in the real world, in real time right now, we are just back from Los Angeles, where we recorded six episodes back to back over the weekend. We got to meet Heath Evans of the NFL Network, who was a 10-year NFL fullback. He played for Bill Belichick for 4 years, and he's very, very much inside the Patriot organization, as well as the Saints and others. We traveled to Iron Addicts Gym, C.T. Fletcher's gym, and we met with him and did an episode there. It's just a remarkable place. So much, you know, just old school equipment in that joint. And then the exact opposite, we went to Gunnar Peterson's gym in Beverly Hills, and it's just a wonderland. It's probably one of the coolest rooms I've ever been in my entire life in terms of specialized machines and memorabilia from celebrities and athletes. Just a phenomenal location. Just absolute craziness. And then we went to his mansion in Beverly Hills and recorded an episode with him and another trainer, Ben Bruno. And it's very interesting hearing the differences in their styles. And on Sunday, we were back at Chris Bell's house, where we recorded an episode with Mike Ryan, another celebrity trainer, but he's also very well known as having been the manager at Gold's Gym in Venice during one of its heydays, let's say. His stories are very funny, and you're probably not prepared for them. Then we had Stone Cold Steve Austin come in. First time that we've had him on the show in person. It was everything that I hoped it would be. It was a great episode. And then we had Frank McGrath, a pro bodybuilder. He has some big ass arms, and he has an interesting story of how he got into bodybuilding and how he almost walked away from it. We also had a no-show on that day. I'm not going to throw that person under the bus, but if you look at our social media, you can probably figure it out. Enjoy this episode from February with MisFit Athletics. I had not heard of these guys before we had them in, but I was very impressed at how they handle individual coaching, even remote individual coaching, and how they're able to make everything athlete-centered. And I think that regardless of what you're coaching, their approach to evaluating athletes' mindset is very valuable, and I think that you will get something out of it. Like this episode, hit that button down there, please, and share it. And we'll be back next week with Simon Otero and Garrett Gonzalez, those guys you guys know better as Masthetics. Support for this episode of the PowerCast comes from Ape Man Apparel. Apparel for people who lift heavy weights at apemanstrong.com. Compex muscle stem products at compexusa.com. Use the code PowerCast and get 28% off all but the lowest price model. Howmuchabench.net, home of Mark Bell's Slingshot. Bench heavy with no pain with Mark Bell's Slingshot. And bodybuilding.com. Bodybuilding.com is the world's largest fitness website and supplement store. Bodybuilding.com has free plans for every level. Visit bodybuilding.com today to become your best self.
Recorded live in West Sacramento, California, this is Mark Bell's PowerCast. This week's guest, the guys from MisFit Athletics. Standing just to the left of Jim McD, here's your host, Mark Bell.
Okay. Hello.
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 Now I appear to be getting something.
Waves. Look at those beautiful waves.
Yep, there we go. All right, so Let's just from the top.
I think now that we've practiced and rehearsed,
they should be even better. Yeah. That's never happened exactly that way before. So welcome to a new era of technical malfunction.
Did we lose the script?
We always lose the script.
Is that my fault?
Script?
Did you guys get the script?
It's all your fault.
It's probably our fault.
Yeah. No, I don't pay attention to emails usually. So
man, there you go. All right. Let's start from the top.
Cool.
Who are you guys again?
I'm Seth Page from MisFit Athletics.
Drew Crandall, MisFit Athletics.
Ted Bonenfant, also MisFit Athletics.
And you're the media guy.
I am the media man. MisFit media man.
All right.
Okay. There we go. Medium in. So, you know, like when you guys, you know, came together and you started a gym, correct?
Yeah, we started a gym.
Right.
About 2009.
When you came together and started a gym, did you recognize right away that media was going to be a part of it, that you needed to have somebody who was going to be putting stuff on Instagram or YouTube or any of this stuff? Actually, Instagram might not even been around when you started, but even just YouTube and other forms of social media. Is that something you recognized early on or was something later? Or?
Well, we tried, and it was fucking terrible. Like, people were into it because we were trying, because they liked the message, but... It's embarrassing to go back and look at it.
It's pretty funny.
It is funny. It's a nice little evolution.
Camcorder from all the way on the other side of the room. You can't hear what you're saying.
Our concepts, gear, t-shirts.
Oh my god.
Nope. No good.
Fucking images looking like Minecraft and shit. Right.
Yes.
All pixelated.
Mm-hmm. Everything's on a tripod. There's no movement in the camera at all.
Wasn't great.
Yeah.
There's really no other way to put it. So.
I still can barely edit.
So obviously,
Instagram videos.
When he showed up.
Yeah, I mean, the goal was to just make these guys look good.
Right. Really.
How long ago did you start?
MisFit Athletics was started late 2011, early 2012, but the gyms, Drew and I have been doing CrossFit and specifically looking into the sport side of CrossFit, not so much just the traditional methodology and affiliates since 2008. So.
Okay. One of the reasons why you guys, we have you here today is, you know, a lot of times Jim and I, when we do podcast or just when we're out somewhere at some of these trade shows and stuff, people are asking him a lot, how'd you get this started? How'd you get this going? The podcast, things like that. And so I like to bring people in to kind of explain, hey, how'd you get this going? You guys have a successful business. You're programming online. You're training people in your gym. You're doing all these different things. And so that's part of the reason why you guys are here. So let's kind of get into how have you guys made an impact? How have you guys been recognized? Because there are so many people in the industry trying to do similar things.
What do you think?
In terms of how we've been recognized and where the separation comes from, I think we feel a really strong connection with our community. We get really excited to go to our training camps because a lot of times it's repeat people being there. Right. We get to meet a lot of new people. We get to have those four or five skeptics in the crowd and get really excited about changing their mind over the course of a couple of days. You know, we travel to regionals and we spend half the time hanging out with, you know, the followers of the website at regionals, go out to dinner with them, things of that nature. So, I don't think that there was some sort of like conscious effort to do this as much as it was, we're just a couple of normal dudes at like CrossFit. So it happened really naturally.
But that's important too. You know, like each little thing that a lot of times when somebody's mentioning, oh, it just kind of happened naturally, a natural progression, because we opened a gym and then people started asking us questions. And then we found out more and more people started asking us questions. Yeah. And then we started to write programming and we're writing and writing and writing. And then now we're realizing we can't reach as many people as we need to. And so then somebody may start thinking of doing an app or a website, or is that somewhere where you guys started to kind of drift towards is, you know, how do we reach more people?
Well, I assume you started this gym because of your passion for the sport of powerlifting, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You wanted everything to do with it. You wanted to bring as many people into it as possible.
Yeah, and my main reason was for selfish reasons to improve myself. And I knew that I couldn't get better by myself. The workout that we had today was because we trained together.
And your brand has grown because of your passion for it.
It's, right.
The story couldn't be more identical for how it's worked for us within That's CrossFit. Awesome. It's we worked out together. We needed equipment in a garage. So we got more friends together to pool a few bucks together to be able to buy our barbells and our bumpers. That starts to spill over into something that's too big for a, you know, one car garage. And then it leads into a two car garage. And then it leads into, okay, we actually have a few people here that are willing to pay some money. Let's get a tiny warehouse space. And then it snowballs from there, right?
Any of those early guys kind of being like, hey, what about, you know, I was part of it in the beginning.
Oh, we have all of our early guys are still there.
They're still there.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. And that's
cool. Max wore that terrible purple shirt that we made to Clue Camp recently just to be like, this is the original shit.
Yeah,
right here.
This is so
original this crappy is, purple shirt.
Yes.
It's
like dog pissing shirt on the fire hydrant. He's like, I've been here, guys. I've been here. But so from there, like, the passion's what built it. And then we, like I said before, we were really interested in the sport side of things. While this CrossFit market's exploding and everyone's doing kind of the certs and focusing on their PVC pipe lifts and all the stuff that's really great for an affiliate gym and for teaching the soccer moms safely and the progressions of movements, we're already like, okay, this is great, but we see a sport developing. It's still in the dirt back in 2008, 2009. Right. It's out in a ranch. There's no StubHub Center. There's no ESPN, right? But we're like, this is fucking cool. Like, this is the sport we want to get involved with. And just recognizing that it was a sport and not just a training methodology gave us this huge head start in this whole field. So people are in the surrounding area in the Northeast started recognizing that we were working with some of the better athletes and really focusing at the time for free all of our energy on getting these guys as good as possible. More and more people asked to be a part of it. Eventually, Drew and I can't keep up with the demand. And when I say that, it's like 12 people. But we still can't keep up with 12 people running a brand new gym. Like, it's a lot of shit going on, and we're still learning.
We have full-time jobs at that point, too.
Yeah, we both had full-time jobs. So we're juggling a new gym, trying to work with these competitors, and we both have 40-hour week jobs.
What were your jobs?
I was a law enforcement officer.
Really?
Yep, for 8 years.
Construction, project manager.
Wow.
Yep.
Yep. So we both had actually stressful jobs in our own way. From there, like, the demand grows and he has the idea, let's just put it on a website. That way people can go to one centralized location. We'll give them options. So depending on their weakness, they can pick the thing they need to plug in, because for people who are not as familiar with CrossFit, there are just so many modalities and domains within the sport that you have to be great at, that you have to be able to choose the weaknesses that you need to work. There's never going to be a one-size-fits-all program. There has to be some customization available to you. So we built this blog. Within 6 months, he's getting emails from people all around the country and then all around the world asking about, you know, do you guys sell t-shirts? Do you guys do camps? How can I get more attention from you? And we're like, what the fuck is this? Like,
yeah, why do these people happen? Care
yeah,
about
why, us? Who are we? We're up in the middle of nowhere, Maine. It's snowing on us and like people are seeking our attention. So we just kind of like fostered it and we continue to put the passion into it that we had to start the whole thing. And it's snowballed out of control. And with that, our experience as coaches gets to grow exponentially beyond others, because we now get to work with all these athletes from back to 2008 to present day, watching the evolution of the sport and watching the evolution of the CrossFit athlete. Now we have this huge advantage in a brand new sport. Other coaches want to get in on this remote coaching game now, but people know we've been around and they know the athletes that we've put out that, you know, came from nowhere and then appeared on ESPN. So the reputation's there and it's just kind of continuing to grow.
I think one of the great things that has come from CrossFit has been accelerated learning. You know, coaches getting around other coaches and athletes getting around other great athletes and other great coaches. It has brought people together that normally probably wouldn't come together. You know what I mean? And so things that may have taken decades to learn or acquire, obviously the internet is a huge part of that. It's probably number one. But I think CrossFit has been a big part of it as well. And we, you know, talked a little bit about at breakfast about increasing somebody's work capacity and people just being able to take on more and more. And the level of fitness that's required for CrossFit, while sometimes at the highest level, can sometimes pull you away from, like if we're trying to be strong, can sometimes pull you in a direction that you don't want to go. Whenever you're trying to strive towards one thing too much, sometimes you lose some other attributes. It's just kind of the way it goes. But the CrossFit principle is to try to keep everything fucking on point all the time. Right. It seems
a difficult balance that is.
It seems brutal, but I think a really eye-opening thing, I think something that has leaked from CrossFit into powerlifting has been the frequency. And I know that a lot of it has come from Olympic lifting too, because Olympic lifting's in CrossFit and so on. But I do think that CrossFit, in my opinion, is really, really responsible for powerlifters understanding, hey, you know what, if I'm in better shape, if I can lift more often, then I can lift more weight. And in our time in the sport, we've seen lifts go up by probably over 100 pounds.
And the crazy thing being that the raw lifters are now approaching the numbers that the geared lifters were doing in, you know, 2006, crazy. 2007, 2008, you know.
And also, the guys that get drug tested, and we don't know what their deal is or whatever, right? But they are getting drug tested. the guys that are drug tested are breaking all-time world records that are held by guys that didn't compete in a drug-tested federation. So I do think that CrossFit is responsible for that. They're teaching people that if you are in better shape and you can handle more shit, then you can not only get in better condition, but you can get stronger.
CrossFit's also responsible for girls in booty shorts.
Yes.
Hey, now.
It's like really interesting this morning how you framed that, though, because you said not that volume was the most important part. It was being able to handle that volume. And we have people who try to go from here to here in a day. And they think that because they watch these videos, and whether it's in your community, they watch your videos, our community, they watch some of the people with the higher volume, that that volume is the whole point, and that there aren't steps, and that there aren't, you know, I need to increase my volume by 10% and then 20 and then 30.
Right.
It's I need to increase it by 100%. Today. Then they half-ass the whole session, and it does nothing for them. So when you said that this morning, it really like clicked with me. They need to be able to handle it. It's not just the volume.
Yeah.
You need to be able to handle it. And I 100% agree with that. I just want to make sure that, you know, I'm sure there's going to be plenty of CrossFitters listening to this. There is a path there.
Yeah.
It's not A to Z.
Right.
It doesn't work that way. So, you know, that was just, I thought that was really interesting.
It's
the way
probably
that you framed
that. You know, because again, the internet is a blessing and a curse in a lot of ways. I mean, thank God for so much free porn. However,
what was the world like before that time?
Yeah, well, I could tell you about
it. That's for another episode. Yeah.
You used to be able to go out in the woods and you would find a cache of dirty magazines. This is true.
Oh, wow.
No one understands why this was the case, but it was indeed true.
Yeah. I think it's just people protecting our youth is what it was.
Fair enough.
You know, somebody dropping off little presents for a teenage kid to enjoy, I guess. As weird as that sounds.
When you put it that way.
Yeah. I don't even remember what we were talking about.
I don't know either.
Who cares? All right. Who cares at this point? You know, we went off the tracks.
I will add one little thing because I sort of remember what we were talking about. When you were talking about the point about when you have to be on point with all parts of your game in CrossFit.
Right.
And this morning we chatted about practicing things. And you just put us through a pretty brutal session, some movements that we're familiar with, but we don't know how to do properly because we don't practice them. We don't train them. They can easily be a part of a successful CrossFit program, strength building, accessory work, all that stuff. It fits in there perfectly if you know how to find that balance. And the other part we talked about, again, was that practice side of it. And one of the biggest things that I still think that I'm juggling in my head when it comes to running a CrossFit program is what do you practice and how much time do you get to dedicate to practice over training? Because practice and training, as you know, we talked about, are two different things, right? Training, you need to apply intensity. You need to already have that movement down to be able to put it to work. And practice is focusing on the movement so that you have that kind of ingrained in your brain. And it's automatic when you need to call on it, right? So one of the biggest things that I struggle with is where's that line of training and practice in a sport that requires so many different aspects of your game? How do you, I mean, powerlifting is not necessarily any simpler than CrossFit. How do you, like with your athletes, decide when you practice and when you train? Like, where's that
line? Powerlifting gets, it's weird because, you know, we got three lifts to worry about and it's all one rep maxes.
Right.
So it almost doesn't seem like there's, you know, that much that's difficult, but it's really difficult. And the lifts are like unrelated to each other. You know, for some guys that are built certain way, sometimes they can squat and deadlift really well, but sometimes they struggle on the bench. And, you know, there's going to be holes in your game no matter what you're doing. Even with Olympic lifting, where there's only two lifts, there still could be somebody who has a glaring weakness that doesn't allow them to do certain things. I think the main thing is to try to focus on, you know, where are you going to be able to make your mark? Where are you going to be? Like, if you're really good at deadlifting, to me, the focus should be deadlifting. The focus should be to try to increase your strength on the deadlift. Now, obviously, you do want to work on some of your weak points. You want to focus in on some of the weaknesses and stuff like that. But a lot of times, from what we've seen, I don't want to say you're screwed, but a lot of times your weaknesses will always be there. You can improve them. You can get better at them. You can make them stronger. But a lot of times they just sit there for years and years and years. Default positions we see people's bodies get into when they go to do a squat or a bench or a deadlift with heavy weights, we have not really seen that many people really truly correct it.
No, and it's usually anatomy driven.
That's what I figured, mechanical issues.
Yeah. Or you know, perhaps you have somebody who is 170 pounds and they don't want to be 270 pounds,
right?
Which is fine. You know, like they don't want to make that sacrifice to gain that kind of weight. But I think, you know, the true balance of everything comes in, we have so many exercises to select from. The methods never really change. The methods have been the same forever. I think the Russians have studied them pretty damn well. You're not going to really see too many different things, although somebody may say, I do strength in the morning and I do this in the afternoon, and there's some, but they're not really new concepts. All we really have is new exercises being done in different ways. And maybe it's not even a new exercise, but it could be an old exercise that somebody fucking forgets about that they kind of bring back to the forefront. We were doing those good mornings today, and we did them two different ways. We did kind of a high rep. We did, and we also did them very slowly. The ones that are really slow, those were that.
Fucking awful.
Yeah, those were terrible.
That was so.
I felt like Bambi.
Yeah.
I missed out, so I don't.
Yeah, that my was, headstrings are still singing.
And I think that is the beauty of it, is we have so many options in front of us. And I think when you're trying to program for CrossFit, you're trying to program for powerlifting, I think you're trying to figure out, where can I spend my time and where can I make my money, and where, you know, can I justify each thing that I'm doing through the course of this day? So powerlifting, we simplify it. I think we do a good job of simplifying. I think a lot of it has come from Louis Simmons. And I think that basically by saying you're going to work on a main movement, now whatever programming style you want to actually do, that's kind of a different topic.
Right.
There's many different ways of achieving that, but basically you lift heavy, and over a period of time you lift heavier. Kind of the way it works. You toggle the intensity, you toggle the frequency, and you toggle the overall volume, right? But when you bench press, the rest of the day is dedicated to all things involving improving your bench press. When you squat, it's the same thing. If you did 5 sets of 5 or 10 sets of 10, or it doesn't matter what you did, it doesn't matter if you're in season, off season, or otherwise, after you squat, you do other things that help your squat. After you deadlift, you do other things that help your deadlift. And so powerlifting has helped simplify all aspects of training for me, because if I talk to someone who is into bodybuilding and they're trying to talk about, they want to bring up their chest, I can think of, okay, well, bench pressing is a pretty good way, or any form of bench pressing, whether it's a barbell or dumbbell, is a pretty good way for us to get a really good stimulus. It's a pretty good way for us to handle something heavy, which can be important for growth. After that, we want to work on all things that are going to improve. If the chest is a weakness, we want to work on all things that can improve the chest. Now, that could be a wide array of things. Like maybe by increasing the strength of your triceps, doing some close grip work, maybe that helps your bench press. So would that possibly help the growth of your chest? Potentially, yes. So that's where things start to get a little tricky, is right, because you're trying to figure out. But I think if you want to be able to justify a lot of these things, if you are a CrossFitter and you frequently have issues with your squat, you're going to want to try to figure out, not only how do I just increase the strength of my squat, because you're going to die out quickly by just trying to go heavier in your squat all the time. You got to figure out, can I make a commitment to really make some change in 2017? Can I really try to measure my quads every other month to see if I can get them fucking bigger, you know? And can I squat, you know, work on squatting more, you know? Maybe potentially having your legs too big for CrossFit can be to your detriment because of the running and so on. But if that's something that you're thinking is a weakness, something so simple could really help it. And so you might have to apply bodybuilding techniques. You might have to apply powerlifting techniques. You might have to apply techniques from a sprinter. You look at Jason Kalipa, he applies all different kinds of methods. He's got some of the best coaches. He's got access to some of the best people in the world in these different fields that he can go to kind of lean on for some of these things.
What I'm finding is super interesting about CrossFit is bringing these domains together. Like there are lots of strength coaches out there that would say, oh, if you need to get stronger, then you better stop running and rowing and biking, because that's going to hurt. Or, oh, if you're trying to get conditioned, then you really got to back off the strength work and only focus on that long slow. Or, you know, you have all these aspects of these specialist coaches that are telling you, no, one thing at a time. But that won't always work in our sport when you have so many things to worry about. You have to be able to balance the strength work with the, you know, traditional like CrossFit couplet, triplet, Metcon style work with the accessory work. And then with, you know, whether it's an extra lift or whether it's just straight up like monostructural sprinting or long set, like you have to cover all these things almost on a daily basis at the highest level because there's so much to practice. And the big question is like, so let's say you're working on strength work and you're just not that you're not strong enough. Do you sacrifice a little bit of that conditioning to try to pick up the strength, or you know, where is the line? And I don't think it's defined yet. In fact, I know it's not defined yet. Right. I don't think anyone has any hard evidence as to like, you know, this is scientifically where it would be, because this is sort of our field of exploration now, right?
Yeah,
this is where we get to go, and this is. Kind of,
I think that's okay to admit that too.
Yeah.
Even though you're coaching and you're programming, I think it's a smart move to admit that, like, we don't know everything that needs to be known.
If you look at our programs,
we know as much as we can.
Our programs have changed, like, I mean, if we went back and looked at the shit we used to write down back in 2010, we'd be like, please take that off the internet.
Well, we did that. We changed our website over in April, and just for fun, we clicked on. You know, MFT number one, which was like October 2012, something like that. And it was like,
That was probably an interesting approach.
But there are probably some great things to it, such as...
It was very simple.
Very simple. The simplicity is probably there. And perhaps, maybe then, maybe you wrote five more exercises than you would normally prescribe now or something of that nature. You know, where it had just kind of a rawness to it.
We established in the part that we lost that Seth has actually, 90-something percent of the programming?
I write basically the main template for the blog that everything is kind of pulled off of. So we've, for years, Drew and I have discussed what the CrossFit Games season looks like. So we have cycles that we've developed. We develop four cycles a year plus in-season competition cycles that keep you being able to train yet not affecting the way you compete. So our cycles, the focus is, I wouldn't say it's set in stone, but we're very comfortable with the way they work and we continue to improve the things within the cycles. So I write basically the bulk of what goes in those cycles. And then from there, it's all changed by a number of coaches for individual athletes, for masters athletes, for teenagers, for people who need a scaled version of it. You name it, for affiliates, we can modify it. But I mean, I get a lot of the credit, but I'm just writing like the concept down and it's being customized in 100 different ways for what people need.
The framework.
Yeah.
You also mentioned how many coaches you have working for you now.
Yeah. Like double digit coaches doing work with different affiliates and different individuals all around the world.
And like, just what do their days look like? I mean, how much of every day do they spend coaching? They respond? Because obviously a lot of it's remote, right?
Yeah. Is there text and email and so on?
It is so dependent on the athlete that they're coaching. There are some athletes that are a little bit needier than others.
There are people laughing right now.
Yeah. And the funny thing is they know who they are, but they also know that they can rely on their coach to either respond. Some of our coaches respond all day, and then some of our coaches batch. We just make sure that they're doing their job and that the athlete's happy. So this can really go from as much as you get someone who, you know, the two people that come to mind for me are Travis and Sam. They do what you write down on the piece of paper and they work as hard as they can. And then they go home and they go to bed. Like that's their day.
Mm-hmm.
And
no complaints.
Sometimes you have to pull stuff out of them. Hey, I need to see this video. Let's make sure we're improving on this. Very self-motivated people. And then there are other people that, you know, they'll send me a set of squats and they know it looks good. And they know that they look stronger and they know that they've done what I've asked them to work on and they just want me to respond. And sometimes
my stance be wider?
Sometimes for fun, I don't respond. And then they're like, he doesn't respond. And I'm like, to you trying to fucking show off? What would I respond to that?
Tension seeking behavior.
Yeah. It's not Dex or Joe.
Is it hard to sometimes match up the coach with the client?
Yes and no. I think our coaches over the years have learned to adapt more to the athlete. We've run into that problem a little bit in our affiliates because it sort of is partially a clubhouse mentality. Yeah. When the gym is closed, we still open the doors and you can walk in and work out if you want to, but it's kind of becomes the lion's den a little bit. And I remember all the way back in like 2010, a kid that I trained with during the day would come to class sometimes at night. Yeah. And I'd kind of fuck with him a little bit. And he quit the gym because he was like, I don't appreciate you talking to me that way. And I was just like, what do you mean? We talked, when we're squatting at noon, you're perfectly fine with it or whatever. And so it was like one of those things where I was like, oh shit, I'm running a business here. I need to dial this back, yeah. A touch. But within that competitive atmosphere, there's almost, you'd have to do something really wrong for it to be out of bounds, because a lot of times when you do something wrong, there's passion attached to it, and the athlete will notice that that's why you're acting the way that you are. So there's been a lot of learning experiences along the way, but we do pay attention to who's going to who, personality wise, but we're a lot more flexible than we used to be.
You mentioned CrossFit being in the dirt years ago at the ranch.
Yep.
Do you guys miss some of that?
I don't. I think it's nostalgic. it's cool to go back and watch, like, wow, look where it came from. But I love the evolution of the sport. There are a lot of things. I mean, I'm not trying to, I would never bash what's going on, but there's always room for improvement in every sport and every field.
Right.
And I think they're taking really good steps. I love the sport of CrossFit. I'm totally obsessed with it. It's why I am where I am. And no, I don't miss the dirt. I mean, if you want to go have one event and do a trail run, great. But like the stadium setting is very exciting. It's very viewer friendly. It's TV friendly. When things get more mainstream, there's more money for the athletes. The athletes get better. The sponsors get bigger. The sport keeps growing. So for my longevity's sake, right, for my company who trains athletes trying to be a pro, like I need the sport to continue to grow too. But I love the direction it's going for the most part.
What percentage of your athletes are people who have legitimate shot at the games and then...
Ooh, percentage
should
of
I say that?
Percentage of people that come to our website or percentage... Because our website, you can go and do the workouts
without...
Yes. So if you go to MisFitAthletics.com...
Give me the number you're comfortable with.
I mean,
this is easy. How many athletes have been in the games that you've coached?
There you go.
We just hung up 10 jerseys like last week from people from last season. So
awesome.
And we have a bunch from before. And this season's, we could literally double that this year.
It gets bigger every year.
One thing that I'm very proud of personally is the fact that we built a bunch of, we didn't build them. We assisted athletes in their growth. I never take credit for what they did. We assisted the athletes in their growth from people who either weren't even qualifying through the first level of competition now to not only getting to from the open, which is the first level, to regionals, the second level, then to the games and being successful there. And when people from the outside ask, where did these guys come from? What did they do? It's nice for us to say, they did the workouts we wrote and they fixed the movements we asked them to fix. And then they worked their fucking ass off for 2 years and now they're pro athletes. So the road is paved if you want to take it. It's a lot easier said than done. But because we've been able to pave the road and send a few people down it, now others that are already higher level but are looking to refine their game are knocking on our door, which is great. We want to work with them too, but we will never forget our roots. The fact that we've sent multiple individuals to the CrossFit Games that no one's ever heard of before. That's why we're stuck in a firm position.
It's awesome. Is CrossFit finding the fittest people in the world, you think?
Yes. Well, hold on.
You have to define fitness in your own way. That's the problem.
Well, I think that part of the issue or part of the issue that people have with CrossFit is that they're just defining their own version of it, right? But at the same time, you could say that about anything. Is the NBA finding the best basketball team? Well, through the way that they play basketball and the rules that they have, yes, they are.
Yeah.
So with CrossFit, though, do you guys feel that they're truly finding, some of the fittest people in the world, the fittest teams in the world and stuff like that? Or do you think there's maybe some other ways to go about it?
Well, go ahead. I'll throw mine
phone
into
call from Casper.
No, I'm not.
I'm on the side of the fence that the only way to me that someone out there is fitter than these guys is that they haven't found the sport, trained for the sport, and joined into the CrossFit Games. That's personally my opinion. I haven't seen a test that covers anywhere near the amount of stuff. And the only reason I say that about really training that aspect is because, do you really expect a decathlete to come in and be able to do kipping pull-ups and GHD sit-ups and squat cleans and things of that nature? For me, though, you asked the question about the teams. Well, the best athletes are all doing the individual. Ah. So you have to, obviously, other than Froning, yes. most of the best athletes are doing individuals. So the team side of things is extremely top heavy right now. So that's one thing that will continue to get better. And then you're starting to see, you know, these kids that are winning the teen CrossFit games.
Yeah.
That's when I think it's official. You put the stamp on it. You know, these people are finding out about this sport. They are not playing football. They're not playing baseball, and they could.
They're being homeschooled.
If you want to say that they couldn't, you're nuts, because there's a bunch of
pulled out of school.
You know, people like Froning that could have been a professional athlete that chose to go back home and do CrossFit instead. So, I think it needs to grow for that label to be. You know, we can't argue this anymore.
Right.
But it's on the exact right path, in my opinion.
Right. So, yeah, the more money, the more sponsorship, the more opportunities that are provided by it, probably the more athletic, more genetically gifted people that jump into it.
And I mean, you look at there's so many examples, but you have Ben Smith, who, you know, potentially could have been a professional baseball player. You have Matt Fraser, who potentially could have been an Olympian had he not broke his back, you know, for weightlifting. Mm-hmm. You know, these are real professional athletes.
Right.
And they're showing what they can do. They're different than everybody else in the sport.
Is the money going to have to trickle down to the lower levels to keep drawing people in?
Yes and no. So the people in the lower levels are going to have to find a way to make money, whether it's own a gym that is paying the bills or coach at a gym that's paying the bills, which is becoming, I think, increasingly more difficult for people to do. I mean, there's a lot of affiliates out there, but there are not necessarily a lot of successful affiliates out there, just like any gym, right? There's a whole bunch of gyms all over the world that are just
Gold's Gym or whatever.
Yeah. I mean, so
businesses, period, honestly, because not every business is set up to succeed.
Correct.
Location and personnel and whatever.
A million,
you know,
things, right? Yeah. So the athlete's going to have to be a full-time athlete. So if the money's not trickling down from sponsors or events or whatever, I don't know. You're going to have people that are maybe a little more affluent that are, you know, getting paid for by family, whatever, stuff like that. But
so it'll be more like golf and tennis.
It depends. Like, because college athletics could start putting things like this in there. And there are places where someone was talking about, like, was it IMG or whatever, like, eventually looking for athletes that are training this style of athletics, because functional fitness isn't anywhere.
You mean like an agency?
Yeah, like agencies. So like, instead of recruiting basketball players, they may recruit kids that are actually doing this down the road. I mean, when the money gets bigger and when the sponsors get bigger and when, you know, if the games continue to grow, that's what would have to happen to continue to fill the field with the actual people that you're looking for.
Because the ratio between winners and competitors is probably the worst in CrossFit.
Oh, it's hilarious, right? 350,000 people for this year's Open that's going on right now.
Right. Well, and even looking at the games,
right,
versus who wins versus who competes in the games. It's
the top half?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
You have to athletes pay to register for regionals.
Yeah, hundreds of dollars, right?
Yeah.
Cost money. After you qualify, they charge you money to go register.
Cost money to do the Open and everything. I mean, right?
Cost money to do the Open.
Yeah, I get the Open. The Open makes sense to
me. $20.
You know, that's a big thing for them. That's a big source of income for them. And anybody can sign up for it. And they're providing
And they need a lot of coaching. And
I think if they want to branch out and really find a reason for somebody to sign up and like strive to be that professional CrossFit athlete, some money is going to have to trickle down. Because you may be limiting your field. Somebody that wants to be a famous football player, they know that if they become a pro football player, they can make millions. As a pro CrossFitter, there's a chance you're going to the games and making zero.
Living in Sherb's basement.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. That's exactly the point I was getting at.
Yeah. Yep. I think you're limiting the scope of people.
There's probably more people that play, more kids anyway, that play basketball, football, baseball, whatever, growing up and never even get to see the light of a high school team, college team, or professional team. But one thing that I actually think, I believe in CrossFit is when these athletes are getting a little older and they're finding the sport, usually in their late teens, 20s, whatever, at least that's been the trend nowadays, is that I actually think the best athletes are coming from those that have played those sports before as really young kids. And I think actually if you look back at the paths that these games athletes have taken, for the most part, you would find patterns in their activity as children, because people like to say, oh, they're genetic freaks. I can't get there because they're all genetically gifted. No, they've been like changing their tissue since they were 8 years old, and building patterns of, you know, activity and coordination since they were five with their dad. Yeah. So yeah. that's why they're
Froning and Ben.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of similar.
You look at their documentaries, they've been playing every sport since they was a child.
Running around and beating the hell out of their siblings and all
that. No early specialization.
Right. Yeah. So that's the one thing I think that will help keep our sport alive is because there are so many kids playing all these other sports that eventually get washed out. If they have this background and they're actually decent athletes, they just have to kind of get the top layers pulled back a little bit to find it. CrossFit can introduce them to something brand new, and you can kind of find that competition side that you maybe missed because you got cut from your college, or you didn't make it on a college team, or whatever the hell it is. You know what I mean? You can find that and almost reinvent yourself that way. I think that's why the field will continue to be big, because people will continue to do that, and they'll have a base to build off.
It feels like an athletic career extender.
It kind of is, right?
In a lot of ways.
Oh, it is.
That's what it is right now.
Big time.
Well, powerlifting is kind of the same way, except there's just no money. But a lot of people played football, played baseball, played whatever, end up in powerlifting because they liked lifting and they really can't play their sport anymore. So,
just a pet peeve of mine when someone says, "Oh, he's genetically gifted." No, he's been fucking working since he was four. You just don't see it.
Yeah, there might be a combination, and you know, like,
I mean, that's a part of it. But I'm saying, like. Yeah. People aren't just waking up from being, well, I guess Travis was a couch potato, but he even did things as a kid. I'm just saying, the typical games athlete isn't waking up one day and going, "No, I'm going to get to the CrossFit games."
Right. Like,
they have a pattern of behavior since they were a child.
Well, and true genetic freaks are a lot more rare than people understand. I mean, you know, we've been open for, you know, around 11 years or so, and there really has only been. There's kind of only been about one that was truly a genetic mutant, and that's a guy named Eric Spoto, who bench pressed 727 pounds.
It's a large bench.
You know, he trained very hard and everything, but it was more like a culmination of he just worked out in the gym. He liked working out, and then he came to our gym. It's the first time he's ever been on film. He benched 635 twice, and you know, I was encouraging him. We got a couple other friends that were encouraging him to go into competition. He never competed before. And we're like, "You're really close to the record." He's like, "Oh, that's cool." You know, he doesn't really know. And then, you know, when it comes to like a squat or a deadlift, you know, then you find out he's really gifted at those lifts as well. And then it just keeps getting worse and worse. And you find out that he's just a total mutant all around because he has beaten some of the world's best arm wrestlers. He's just fucking kicked their ass without a lot of arm wrestling training. And, you know, Stan Efferding is another one that kind of comes to mind. But I wouldn't really just put him in the category of genetic freak. Like, he might have a genetic disposition to be able to acquire muscle mass when it comes to
lean muscle
strength
mass
training. Yeah. He's an ectomorph, and so he's able to put on tremendous amounts of weight and tremendous amounts of muscle and all kinds of things. But, you know, a real genetic freak is rare.
Very rare.
It's hard to get them to work, too.
Yeah.
And why would they care
about CrossFit? Like, honestly, like, where's the fame and where's the money? Like, there's not really, like, MMA offers it better, NFL football. I mean, all these things, they tend to, at least in your head for now, maybe that'll change with CrossFit. But it seems like those things are, you know, those things are where you get the fame and the fortune.
Yeah, I mean, those are the mainstream sports right now.
Right.
I mean, everyone's making the shift to MMA. And, I mean, everyone wants to be a fighter these days until they get punched in the head and then the second guess. But it looks glamorous.
Everybody has a plan to get punched in the face.
Yeah, that's not the old saying.
Yeah. When you look around and you know, you look at some of these people in different sports and you start to kind of wonder, like, hey, I wonder if this guy would be good at CrossFit or that girl or whatever. It kind of is really hard to pick somebody that would be great. Like, you have someone like Bones Jones, dominated MMA, the youngest champion in UFC history and so on. He's arguably one of the better fighters of all time. He has only fought for a short period of time, but he's dominated. And then you kind of look at him and then you're like, well, he wouldn't be great at CrossFit. Because the way his body is designed, he's like too long and too lean, you know, and He's just not built for it. Right. A lot of times what we're seeing right now, the trend in CrossFit is these are shorter guys usually in the 5'6" to 5'9" range, right? Yeah.
Yep.
And no one is really above 200. And if they are above 200, they're just slightly above, right?
Right.
And so it's interesting that you got like Hussein Bolt and Bones Jones, and there's a bunch of other kind of people like that, defensive ends in the NFL, wide receivers in the NFL. They have these long athletic bodies that can do some amazing shit. Hussein Bolt, fastest human to ever walk the face of the earth. But if they tried CrossFit, it'd be really hard for them. There's a lot of exercises in there, too challenging. Even the Olympic lifts alone puts you at some sort of disadvantage right away.
They would be at a massive disadvantage at the early stages, because we have athletes who are more, they're bigger, they're more genetically gifted. But during the open, when the weight is light and the range of motion, you know, how fast can you go through the squats? Mm-hmm. That's a huge thing. So they're actually better off if you place them at regionals or then even place them at the games. They place higher at a harder test. And that's but the problem is if you brought those guys into CrossFit, they'd never make it through the open.
Watching Klokov do grid was like, I thought he was going to die. I really thought he was going to die. And this guy has a motor, but man, the cardio.
Yeah, it's just a different world.
It's a different world, yeah.
Well, sometimes being able to explode into something so, you know, with so much force sometimes isn't a great thing, I would imagine, when you're trying to, you know, quote-unquote pace yourself for some of these things, right?
Well, when we speak about functionality, right, we're talking about tasks that human beings can do outside of the gym, right? That's what they're trying to test at the CrossFit Games. And so when you think about all the tasks, they usually come down to being a push or a pull of some kind, right? So if your limbs are too long or you're too big or you're too small, when the list of tasks gets too long, there are too many things you can't do if you're misshapen. If you fall into that average human being,
misshapen, I like that.
if you fall into that average male, 5'9 to 5'10, and in that, you know, that weight that comes with it, if you're very physically fit and fairly lean, 185 to 200 pounds, then the list of tasks that you're capable of doing is greater than those who have the hindrance with they're built.
It's an interesting like precedent to have, you know, like our champion is going to be average.
Yeah.
Of average height.
The most
and
average.
Of average weight. Now, obviously, with their shirt off, they look like fucking Superman. See you later, Filipino Thunder. They, you know, obviously, with their shirt off, they're fucking jacked and everything. But it is interesting that that's what we come to. And then on the flip side of that, we have the females who aren't like of average size or average weight. They're jacked out of their fucking minds. They look awesome. They got a lot of muscle mass on them.
Yeah.
And you know, for some people that watch it, they're like, they think it's gross. They think it's weird. What do you guys think is the difference? Like, I know the guys have muscle, but the guys don't have excessively, they don't have excessive amounts of muscle the way that the females do in comparison. You know, if I was to think in my head, just the way it would play out is a guy would weigh 230. If he was to equal kind of the muscle mass of some of the females weighing 150 or whatever it is. What do you think the difference is?
I honestly find that the women pay much more attention to nutrition. That's a big part of it. So the guys know that.
That makes a lot of sense.
The guys are going after, you know, I have this much volume. I got a lot of testosterone. And if the fire's burning, I'm going to throw garbage, throw whatever down the hole, and it's going to burn as energy. And, you know, I'm in this, it's not even 1%, it's the 0.1%, you know, whatever you want to call it. So
they're already fairly lean, and maybe they don't see the real value.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Whereas the girls are
Always feel they're too fat and so on.
Girls are very serious with it. Well, I mean, and they do produce, you know, maybe not as much the CrossFitters, but they do produce, you know, whatever it is, an eighth or a tenth of the testosterone. So if you're throwing garbage down that hole, it's going to show up.
Yes.
Yeah. It's going to show up in places. So I think the leanness that you see, I will also say that for anybody that sees these girls only in high definition on the television or on his camera or on your camera, go to a CrossFit gym. They don't look quite like that.
No.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't look quite like that in person. Because like for me, when we shoot in the summer, we go to the lake. Yeah. I love that HD. It's great. It makes me look way bigger than I am.
When you see, also when you see, like, I mean, there's that classic picture of, I'm going to get all hot and bothered here for a minute. There's that classic picture of Froning and Khalipa and Matt Chan.
At the pool. Right.
At the pool. Yeah. Everyone knows that photo. Yeah.
Let's see if we can pull it up for a second. And but, you know, they look fucking jacked. I mean, these guys are jacked. Like, they're in great
shape.
They look
big.
Ted did the photo, photoshopping, right?
Yeah.
You know
yeah.
how to do that.
Yeah, I played with the light.
Yeah, I mean, they look extremely jacked. And
oh, look, it comes up as a...
Yeah.
That combination.
It's a black and white photo.
This one right here.
And yeah, they all just look.
Ooh.
I mean.
Wow.
Hey, goodness is 90% about the lighting.
Yeah. It's a hard light from above. Yeah. That always makes everything look.
It's also probably amazing. After they just swam and they're all.
Swimming and bar muscle ups.
Yeah. And they're all pumped. So I guess what I'm saying is that we could look like that very easily if we swam a lap in a pool.
Right. Well, that's what I'm going to do very this true. Summer. Yeah.
It's just like NBA players. Like, you see them on TV and they're all as tall as each other. And then you see them in person. You're like, that's a mutant. That person is gigantic.
Yeah. And the shortest guy on the court was 6'5".
Right. Like, these guys are all similar size, so standing next to each other, they look like monsters. But,
so there was short. A competition 6 months after this picture was taken, because this was all over the place, even in the CrossFit community.
Matt Chan's abs look fucking crazy. They look like they're pissed. Yeah. They look like they're angry.
So we go to this competition, and Froning's there, and he's in backup. He's in the warm-up area, and he takes his shirt off to warm up, and I'm like, what? I mean... As normal looking as, you know, a healthy gym goer, you know.
You got maybe guys in your gym that look a little bit similar.
Exactly.
Yeah. Give or take some pounds, right?
The workout had rope climbs in it. He walks off after the workout and looks like he gained 40 pounds. The pump that guy pulls off within a short period of time is messed up. He went from looking like an average Joe, because he isn't a very big guy. He's like, I think he's like 5'8", something like that. Yeah. He weighs, 185, 195 pounds. But after he walked off, it was just like, what the hell is that?
The optical illusion of additional detail.
It was incredible. I couldn't believe it. It makes
everything look huge. That's why, like, when they used to build models for movies and stuff like Star Wars and Star Trek and stuff, the amount of detail that they put in to a small model would allow them to make it look enormous.
Right.
Under lighting. And it's... These guys are the same thing, really.
What I find interesting about the picture, too, is, like, you know, these are three legends in the CrossFit community.
Yep.
And especially with Froning and Khalipa, I mean, it looks like they're just bros. It looks like they go to the gym and bro out and get a pump and hit a bunch of pec work and a bunch of bicep work. Do you guys think that is, these guys obviously have a history of that.
Yes.
Jason freely admitted that to us. Broing out.
Almost every CrossFitter started in a gym like that.
Yeah.
You just start with CrossFit.
And I heard that, when anybody's ever seen Froning, whenever they've seen him, even like on a vacation, he's like in the gym doing something with weights. Like, he just keeps fucking lifting.
They're addicted to exercise.
Yeah. And you guys think there's something to that, like with some of the guys that you have that are maybe 170 or 180 and they're just slightly above, slightly below the kind of norm for being a top CrossFit athlete? Is that something you guys maybe encourage? Like, dude, like, I'm sorry, but you got to do some curls, you got to do some shrugs, or a little bit of bodybuilding type stuff?
You definitely could add bodybuilding, and I've seen it in the last year or so. The trend of like a bodybuilding day per week that they're adding to try to add mass in specific areas, because bodybuilding, you can pick where you want the weight
and
to
maybe
go, right?
And maybe a little bit of fun.
And a little bit of fun, right?
Session
a
to like stress. Do something
we do that
different.
We do that shit all the time. Yeah. Yeah,
way
definitely.
Less stress than going through a 20-minute metcon, right?
Right.
Way more fun than CrossFit.
Yeah, I mean,
way more.
You guys can open up a bodybuilding gym.
I mean, our gym is a bodybuilding gym if you want it to be. There's dumbbells everywhere. But as far as gaining weight goes, like, I don't know that we talked about like dedicating time to practice, right? So now we still have all these things I need to practice. Am I going to give an athlete in a day like, okay, you have a 20-minute window now to rip out these sets of curls? Or I could say, all right, you're going to work on extra like weighted lunges or something and try to recruit more musculature for a movement. And while they're eating, fixing their nutrition to add weight, I think they could probably put on weight easier than like that. And then the movements that we know that we're going to deal with, things like muscle ups, things like chest to bar pull ups, handstand push ups. You can do variants of those more specifically and still do strict pull ups instead of the bicep curl or strict dips or, you know, a
You're
bunch of push ups.
Yeah.
So, but it's, and it's a little more applicable to the sport. So in that window, I can not only A, give them practice, but B, give them maybe that area of weakness.
Just not waste your time doing set after set of pec deck.
And it may not be a complete waste of time, but it may not be optimal like we talked about earlier. So, I mean, is there a place for it? Yeah, probably.
Right.
You just got to make sure it actually does fit where they're
right. And who knows what CrossFit looks like 5 more years from now or 10 more years. Like maybe the people that are winning are going to look totally different. Maybe they'll be 6'2". And maybe they'll be 215 or who knows?
Right. Yeah.
We don't know where the evolution of the sport's going to go.
You don't know. We don't know.
What do you guys think of, you know, like Matt Frazier last year? Everyone's seen Rich Froning's dominance. Ben Smith had a good has a good run continuing. He's been there a long time. But Matt Frazier really set himself apart and kind of just set last year's CrossFit Games on fire. Do you think that trend is going to continue with, I mean, he kicked everybody's ass. He kicked everybody's ass. I know you guys have people.
Never bet against Matt Frazier with anything.
But do you, first of all, what do you think is the change for him that made the biggest difference? I do understand that. He's been to the games a bunch of times before. I do understand that he's finished second and third before he got first, right?
Yes.
Second, first. Yep. That's his three performances. Second, first. That's all he's got.
Yeah. So he's never been shitty.
Yeah.
He's never sucked at it.
No. Too bad he's not like cream of the crop or whatever.
You know? Yeah.
But what do you think the difference is between, you know, him coming up short twice? Coming up short is probably not good. He's not very tall. Sorry, Matt Frazier. You know what the difference is between him coming up short twice and then him kicking the shit out of everybody?
Man, he did a really big favor for a lot of coaches out there that can't get their athletes to focus on the little stuff. He went right on camera and said, you know, I was a student. I ate like shit. I
did hear him talk about that.
He said a lot of this stuff, and they asked, and obviously, it's the simple things, the dedication, the hard work, this is not the type of stuff that I should be putting in my body. You saw him in his basement going all out on rowing intervals. And these, for me, when I'm watching this, I'm like, this is when I can really get somebody to do something. You know, it's like, we're going to take the stuff that we learned from you today, and we've said some of it before to our athletes, but when you say it,
right,
that's different. Yeah. You know, this is your world. This is this is the squat. You need to get your hips stronger. This is the way that we can do it.
Right.
And so on. So when he did that, when he was, you know, this is the life of a professional athlete. I sleep this much. I eat this way, whatever. Not only did he catapult himself into what I thought was the greatest CrossFit Games performance ever.
Yeah. Easily. The most points and so on.
Easily.
And dominated.
Yeah. But he also put a template out there that wasn't, you know, there are some of the higher level athletes that are just like, who cares what you eat? Work your butt off. And there's, you know, there's something to that attitude, but there's also something to.
I actually remember watching something that he was a part of, and it was one of the documentaries. And I remember him saying in one sentence, and you can go back and watch what's it called? The 2015, 2016.
Fittest on Earth.
The Fittest on Earth. There you go. You can go back and watch it. And in one instant, he says, I will do anything to be the best. I'm going to, you know, then the next minute he's eating like Lucky Charms. And I remember watching it and it had an impact on me because I know people that are the best. I know people that have, you know, Brian Shaw is somebody who every minute of every day is dedicated towards how do I make myself more optimal? Is this going to help me? Is this food actually fuel for me that's going to help me? And so somewhere along the line, something clicked with Matt Frazier to where he maybe said, I'm 97% in. You know what I mean? I'm 94% in. And then he went to that 100, and that must have been a big factor.
Yep. I think, honestly, with that lifestyle that he had talked about before, you know, he came in second being a part-time CrossFitter.
Yeah.
and think about the stress that that puts on you.
Right.
And then when your body's under stress, it's not recovering and so on. So, I mean, that change was, you know, had to be monumental for him.
Yeah. That must be a huge difference to be able to rest and recover. I mean, recovery from these workouts is...
Because that's the Froning model, right? You watch the documentaries on him. Who the hell doesn't want to have that life? Like,
that's a lot of working out.
I know,
man.
It's a lot of work. I know it's a lot of working out. You can throttle it back a little, but in terms of how calm he seems in his regular life.
Yes.
That's recovery at its finest right there, living that lifestyle, choosing exactly what you do all the time, whenever you want to do it, for the most part. You know, I'm sure he has responsibilities, but, man, that's recovery. So when you take Fraser and you're like, oh, I'm a student and I do this, and I just run out of the classroom and get Chinese food, like, it's different.
Watching him at regionals, too, he seemed to have a different mentality. He seemed to have a fire lit under his ass last year.
Oh, yeah.
You could tell that he was sick.
He looked angry.
He didn't want that second place.
Yeah, in general, he did, right? Like, when they paired him up with Froning and Smith, he was on fire that day. Yeah. And then from that point on, he was just like,
Something confidence-wise had to have switched in him as well, because, like, it almost seemed like he was... And this isn't meant to be an insult in any way, but almost from early on, kind of playing scared, like he didn't want to let somebody else down. He wasn't worried about his own self, more like all the people that had supported him. It almost seemed like he was doing it for other people. And then once he was like, okay, I'm fixing this about myself, my school's done. When he focuses on himself and puts, you know, himself on the line and not doing it for anything else other than him, you can kind of elevate yourself to new levels. You can push yourself. You can do whatever you want to yourself, right? So as long as you're not taking someone else down with you. So once he puts it all on his shoulders, he showed that do or die attitude, like every event, not just like he didn't play the safe Rich Froning, you know, make sure I'm in 10th or better in each event and then wait till the last day of the games and then crush everybody and finish it. Froning was always that smooth, just steady through. Matt went out like he was shot out of a fucking cannon from event one and said, I'm going to show you. And you'll see how the result comes out. And he's not going to not do that this year.
Right.
So, scary.
Yeah, that's got to play into the other guy's head too, right? They got to be like,
So now these other guys are like, oh, if I can't start with him and sprint the first event with him, like I'm in big trouble. So now, not only is he already better than everybody, but now he gets to play games with everybody because he gets to take a step out ahead, hang the cheese and say, come take it. Oh, see you later. And now I just burned you out. Like he can really fuck with people now. It's going to be almost impossible to beat him if he stays healthy. Right. Almost impossible.
Yeah. Putting those seeds of doubt into people's
heads. Yeah. Over and over again. I think he knows how to play the game now.
It's a psychological game at least as much as anything else.
Oh, in 5 years or even less, the top CrossFitters in the world, this is just my way of thinking, the top CrossFitters in the world will not be separated by what they can and can't do physically, but what they can and can't do up here on game day. Whether they show up with this and are willing to suffer, willing to do things they've never done before, willing to adapt to different circumstances.
Overcoming adversity in the course of a particular event.
How do you manage these guys? You know what? I imagine you guys have a bunch of people going to the CrossFit games, right? I'm sure you guys end up there every year and you're assisting your people. You actually brought up a great point. We should talk about that right now before I forget. You talked about having an earpiece. Can you comment on that a little bit more? Yeah. I think that's fucking amazing. Sounds amazing.
It's fresh in my mind because we just went through this series of talks. You know, the Open just started this week, the CrossFit Games Open, you know, how you get to the CrossFit Games. And these guys and girls will work so hard all year long and then 4 minutes into a workout, forget their goals, everything. They're in that pain. They're feeling bad for themselves. So when during the Open, we can just scream right in their face, right in the gym. And you know, we did a couple of days ago, and we're going to do it again when we land Monday morning, and we're just going to keep doing it for 5 weeks. But at regionals, if I'm a couple hundred feet away with the music, you can't hear a word I'm saying. And, you know, last year, you know, watching some of the athletes run on that True Form runner, I don't know if you've used that, but that thing is just a soul sucker.
I know what you mean, yeah.
And they haven't used it that often, and you just see them develop this, you know your athletes, and you know when that look goes on their face. Mm-hmm. You know, we call it bitch face. When you go there, it's really hard to return from that. So if you had that earpiece, if I could, at a given point, just say, hey, don't forget why you're here, what you're doing, because of the pain. You're used to the pain. You do this day in and day out. You put in the work. You earned your spot here. And if you continue to work the way that you can, you're going to earn your spot ahead of here. So,
yeah.
I mean, the goal is to get that like inner dialogue to be what the coach is saying, right? Right. So part of like the mental game is to develop that inner dialogue, which is as hard to develop as any skill in the sport. So Drew will just take the place of their inner dialogue and talk right over it. Like, you're being a bitch. Keep going. Like, right. Don't stop now.
Yeah, breathe, blah, 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 right?
Yeah, whatever it is.
Discouragement.
Depends on the athlete. It really depends on the athlete.
Yeah.
For me, I you know, went through the period of time where I thought I was going to be a CrossFit athlete. Mm-hmm. And I am not.
He's laughing.
I'm not capable. I have some of the physical abilities that you need to do it, but I'm not capable of putting that much work in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it just doesn't balance with my life. And it just wasn't something that I could do that I was interested enough in to do. But I watch these athletes do that. And to me, that's the hardest part, to put the work in, to get the work done. Mm-hmm. And it drives me fucking insane when they don't either realize how good they are or they can't put it out in that atmosphere.
Yeah,
that's all they're working.
You watch boxing or MMA and there's 30 seconds left and it seems like the fight's kind of a draw. You're like, can't you just throw a couple more?
Go!
Throw a couple bombs, you know? But like you said, you know, you're up against the wall and you don't have somebody in your ear.
Right.
Fighting all those negative thoughts of how you're just going to fucking pass out on the mat, you know, any second now.
And, you know, guys, know anybody who's using a sports psychologist in CrossFit?
Other than
coaches.
We're not working with anyone that has one dedicated to them that I'm aware of.
I mean, you almost are a sports psychologist at this point.
Well, I mean, my job is to keep people nice and level-headed and try to just reframe anything they're thinking about, but I have no training in that.
We've actually been contacted recently by a sports psychologist, and the reason why they contacted us is because of the things that we say in our videos. They're like, you guys are going into this territory, you guys are doing a really good job, here's some other things to think about.
Neuro-linguistic programming kind of shit.
How do you talk somebody off the ledge? You know, somebody does go to the CrossFit Games and event one, they fucking tear their whole hand up. They got, you know, their hands bleeding and fucking tape it. There's tons of pain associated with that no matter what you do. And they did some sort of run. Their feet are all fucked up. Like, there's these little things that happen that sometimes maybe the viewers at home or sometimes people that don't do CrossFit maybe don't understand. There's all this painful, weird shit that you have to... I mean, even going from the water to the sand, I mean, you get sand all over your legs, you get some serious chafing going on. There's all these really, like...
Very uncomfortable at all times.
It sounds like it wouldn't be that... You know, it doesn't sound like it's the worst thing ever, but it does fucking hurt. It does, you know, it does seep into your body and your brain. How do you talk some of these guys off the ledge when they get in these... I'm sure they get panicky at points.
Man, we've had bad luck trying that, and we've had really great luck trying that. So we've definitely seen both sides of we've had athletes completely shut down at regionals in the games. And no matter what you say, no matter what tactic you use from event to event, you throw every tool at them you can, they've shut down. And that's the way it's going to be for that day, that season. It is what it is. You can try to work with them to regrow next year, because just like practice, you have to practice the way you're thinking about each training piece, each competition, whatever. So if they're at the games and they haven't experienced doubt, pain, loss, any of that stuff, and figured out how to be gritty enough to overcome it, they're not just going to fucking figure it out at the CrossFit Games. It's all over. You didn't train them for that to begin with. So it's not always that easy just to say, well, you have a lot of experience chatting with athletes, so we'll just throw you in there and you'll figure it out with them. It's a whole long relationship between the athlete and coach and then what they've developed in their mental game over years. Having said all that, that's the basis of it. There are ways to motivate people and get them excited for little things. You set small goals for them. Like, one of the things I use in both competition and training with my athletes is if I don't think something's going to go as great as it maybe should for them, you have them focus on one part of the workout. So, like, let's say there's handstand pushups in a workout, and the athlete that's struggling or having a tough time mentally, great at handstand pushups, you say, no matter what happens, you go back to that wall, you crush the handstand pushups, and we don't care what the rest of the workout looks like, get ahead there. You know, you just give them these little tiny goals, these little steps, small things to focus on that are not so fucking overwhelming, like the whole week is ruined because you just tore your hands up, whatever. Mm-hmm. Keep them focused on little obtainable things and keep their mind off the big picture that feels like it's crumbling in on them like every moment. So just reframing everything.
A more sensitive, adaptive model than we typically see in powerlifting, I think.
Yeah.
Honestly.
it has to be, right? I mean, in powerlifting, I think you guys are, you're both your sport and your athletes, I can't speak about, you know, individual athletes, but in general, are a little more mature. Like, these are kids who are learning all these different things in a very short amount of time going to CrossFit Games. Not only are they mentally not quite developed where they should be yet.
Experienced life-wise.
Exactly. And powerlifters, I feel like, have a big advantage in that. That sort of thing. So you can fucking scream in someone's face, call whatever they want, and they get that. They're trained to have that reaction from that, right?
Right.
Certain athletes, if I fucking call them a bitch, they're like, I'm going home. Like, it's all over. Like, that's it.
You know, another thing, too, is it's always about being better, you know? Like, things go better when you are better. And mental toughness, which you can debate whether it exists or not, but when you're better, you don't have to be mentally tough because you're kicking everybody's ass. So if you get all your shit together, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you guys kind of recognize, okay, this person has a good shot in the games, you know, to finish top 10, and yeah, it'd be wonderful if they crack the top 3 or 5, you know. And they're in the games and they're having a tough time, but they're still in line with finishing kind of where you thought. It's kind of more about being not really tough, but just being realistic. Like, we're doing really good. You put in a lot of work, and truth is you might finish 10th and 9th and 8th and 10th again every year. Cause you there's possibility that you're not good enough to be first because there's so many fucking factors involved in all that. And if you just get stronger and you get better, then you don't really have to worry about being a tough guy in a sense. You know?
Yeah.
Most of the weakness that we see throughout the sport, through all these people that are, I want to be Travis Williams, I want to shut my brain off and just go do this. To me, Travis is that way because he's good, because he works his ass off, and it just creates the scenarios where he can succeed because of that. Mm-hmm. So this huge first step for people is just shut up, stop thinking about it, go put the work in, and you will find that you're just really scared of things, you know, the unknown, the hard work that you're not willing to put in. Because at the end of the day,
you're right.
You get that work done and you're like, oh, we're doing it again tomorrow. And then we're doing it again the next day. And then it just becomes your normal.
Yeah.
And then you go based off that. And there are outliers that, you know, don't really fall into that. But for the most part, just go do your work and you won't have to worry about it at all.
Yeah. There's like Bill Parcells used to talk about your reflection of the record that you have.
Yeah.
If you're 5-5, you can't talk about the bad breaks that you had to be there. You suck.
Right. That's 100% correct.
You're winning half the time and losing half the time, and you're not going to make the playoffs that way.
Yeah.
If you're losing, you have no one else to blame but yourself, especially in a sport like CrossFit. Yeah. Even in team sports, I mean, if you don't shoulder some of that blame and you start putting on other players, that's fucking ridiculous. Like, you blame yourself when you lose, period. And in an individual sport like CrossFit, it's the same thing. People like to come up with every fucking excuse in the book, you know. But, like, again, with Travis Williams, one of the things I think he does, and I can't even be 100% positive, but I think this actually goes on in his head, he's so confident even in things that I know he's not that good at, but he's like, oh, I'm good at it, don't you worry. He's so confident at it, he's visualized how it's going to go in his head before a workout starts or whatever. He's played the scenario out in his head probably a dozen times.
He wins every time.
Yeah, he won the games actually in his head. Like, he's played it out that way, and he goes out there and he delivers, and it may not go to plan, but he's sure as fuck not giving up on what is played out in his head.
Never.
People way under visualize the way that things need to go, and they hope and pray that things go good. Yeah. That's ridiculous. It's such a cop out. Like plan on doing well, visualize how you will do well, and go out there and try to match that visualization. If you don't, then you can expect to fucking lose. Like, that's right. Because if you're not planning on winning, then you're planning on losing. What's the other option? I don't know. They think there's a third option, and there isn't.
I think they're driven by fear a lot.
Of course.
You know what I mean? Just like, I'm gonna fuck up. Everybody's gonna see that I'm a fraud, they just can't picture, you know, crossing the finish line in first position.
Yeah, I think you're right about some of them, but some of our athletes do think they can cross the line in first position, and then they do really well. It might not be first, but they actually finish mid-pack or upper pack, whatever. The ones that are driven by fear typically make a mistake either on purpose or not on purpose, or even subconsciously on purpose, to not set themselves up to be found out to be a fraud or whatever else. Right. I know lots of athletes that have self-sabotage issues, and I'm more than happy to let them stay that way, because dealing with their crazy on the next level is they're not going to get anywhere anyway. Right. What's the point? You know, like, fix the inner demon issue, and then we can start talking about fixing your fucking ring muscle ups.
Like, I think that sometimes in powerlifting, people underperform on purpose because they know they're not going to hit their goal. So the more that they're off, the better they feel, because then they have something to blame it on.
Right.
You know, it's
bad
like
bad day.
Yeah, bad day. Yeah.
Well, in our sport, there's that spotlight at the end. Right?
Right.
So if you're in that scenario where you need to win this event to go to the CrossFit Games, if I don't have to be in that, I don't have to perform there. Right, and I know that my 85% is still pretty damn good, and I'm going to have my sponsorships at the end of the day, and I'm going to come in ninth, and it just is what it is. I mean, we watch it year after year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you get more followers and stuff anyway, regardless of whether you go or not.
That's true statement.
Make the show.
Yeah. People are part of that whole thing.
But what's worse than having regret 5 years later, 10 years later, about like, wow, I had a shot. Or you're telling your buddies, I fucking had a shot at this. Like, no, you didn't. Like, you're full of shit.
Yeah, they're
always like, I actually did. I'm just a crazy person.
Your good friends always say,
Yeah,
that's awesome.
He laughed at me.
Good. Yeah.
He laughs pretty loud.
That's the best friends.
Yeah, best.
All friends laugh at you. Good friends will pat you on the back.
I'm into that.
I remember all your hard training.
What's something you learned in the last few years about business?
Oh, man.
The business you're involved in here with these guys.
One huge thing that I've learned about business is it is very difficult if you are in it alone, which I think is a huge part of why we have found any morsel of success, is because we truly are a team.
Yeah.
The three of us, the two other owners back home, the coaches that we employ, our admin, like, we're a team. We bounce ideas off of each other. We tell each other when they're shit ideas, and we tell each other when they're good ideas. And through that, being flexible and, you know, sharing the knowledge, I think is huge in a business. You can do it alone, and some people do successfully do it alone, but there are support systems that you don't
see.
They're
motivated by different things.
Yeah.
Is there a recipe to the media? Are you kind of thinking about certain posts, certain times a day, the YouTube videos, you're looking to get certain content from these two or the athletes you work with? Or
I mean, there's definitely times a day that are better to post on Instagram than others, and Facebook and all that. My biggest goal with, and it's been this way since the start, is we want people to see the programming for what it is, and we want people to understand the intention behind it. So a big reason that we started even making videos is because people were misinterpreting, like you had said at the beginning, what was being written on the blog. So it was more instructional based. As we've grown and as we've brought more people into our circle, there's more personalities that we feel like need to be highlighted. There are people out there that are asking to see bits of life behind the scenes. So the biggest goal is to get the people out there that we think should be out there and get the information out there in the way that we intend it. We want everybody that follows the blog to follow it and get the most out of it. We want to have easy access for the people that need the information. So those are the biggest drivers behind the media.
How do you get people to follow what you're doing? Is it something that when you're filming these guys, they just say it? Do you put something, like you put a hashtag up, or like what you have, any general things that you're doing that are,
I mean, I feel like we've grown so organically that we've kind of relied upon that organic growth. A huge part of it is the community.
Word of mouth, commenting.
Yeah.
Like, hey, have you watched what they did this week? You know, you see that programming they put up this week?
Yeah, our athletes are huge advocates for us, too. Travis
and
Williams.
How long has word of mouth worked in business?
Since the beginning, when that's all there was.
Right.
Since the first guy that got hired to like carve a stick man on a wall for somebody's living room. Yeah. No, it's huge. I mean, the community is everything for it. Without the community, without the comment section, without, you know, we wouldn't be here.
Right.
We wouldn't be here talking to you.
For yourself, what's the most important thing you've learned about business the last couple of years?
That's a great question. Probably the number one thing for me, in terms of the actual business side, so maybe trying to take a more black and white look at it and separate out some of the community portions of it, is really that when we do go in our separate directions, we kind of know that we can rely on each other. We do a really good job of meeting back in the middle, making sure that we all kind of agree or are on the same page in some regard. But then when we do go out into different places, I never have to wonder if he's going to get like really tired and write a shit program and put it on the website. Right. I don't have to wonder that. I really don't, because he'll say something like, I wrote this shit program the other day on a piece of paper and I crumpled it up and I threw it in the garbage and then I'm just going to stay home tomorrow and do the exact same thing. When Ted disappears to the editing and does all of that,
disappears a lot, doesn't he?
I don't at any point think to myself, you know, these guys are off fucking off somewhere or something like that. So there's something about that level of trust where we can go in our separate directions and we can get a lot of work done. And then we can come back into the middle and make sure that the kind of the vision is there and that we're going out to the community. So for me, having the trust in my business partners, because we do, you know, we have this little like clubhouse basically as an office above our gym. It's really fun, but it's not good for work at all.
If you were wondering what those people were doing
outside of there, I think it might drive you crazy. So that level of trust for me is something that, you know, if you're going to get into business with someone and you're not going to be working
next to them,
make sure that it's people that you trust. And you know, it helps. I mean, he downplays, they both do. He downplays the programming stuff, but you know, we talked about the type of person who has that scientific mind but has struggles to get that kind of thing out into the world. I recognized very early on that I understood these science-based concepts of strength and conditioning, but I lacked the creativity in those CrossFit-specific workouts to be able to put that out there and have it, you know, you have to find new things in CrossFit. And that was something that he was really good at. So we can take these ideas and he can go kind of in that direction. And then with this guy, he'll, you know, go over every single tiny detail and say that it's not good and it's better than anything else that I've seen. It's like, okay.
Video shit, guys.
I think one of the worst things that can happen is having rules, you know, having rules, and you have to have some rules, especially as your business grows. There's just no other way around it. There has to be some.
It's like principles, though, not rules. Yeah, principles to live by.
Right, and I think that micromanagement can drive you crazy. Oh. And I think when you think about the reasons why you don't have a 9-to-5. And you think about the reasons why you wanted to take this journey in fitness and have these three guys with you and so on. It probably wasn't to like manage everybody, and it wasn't to like hover over every decision everybody makes. How is that really different than working for somebody else? Like, because the way that works, when you work for somebody else, you got somebody breathing down your neck and then you breathe down the next person's neck, right? Yeah. I mean, so you end up in the same kind of vicious circle. You work for yourself, you know, to be free and to do the things that you want to do kind of when you want to do them. You mentioned that luxury for somebody like Matt Frazier. Mm-hmm. He's got the luxury of CrossFit is my life. I don't have to worry about a bunch of other shit. And this is what I can do. And therefore, he's able to execute better than anybody else.
Right.
What's something you learned in the last few years?
Well, you just kind of hit it. To go all in on a business, you have to live it. It has to be part of who you are and what you do on a daily basis. That this is not part-time. And when it was actually part-time for us, it wasn't special. It wasn't even worth talking about.
When it was part-time, did you think it would be something that would turn full-time? Because it looked like it was heading in the right direction?
We're happy with how fast it was growing, but we didn't have any idea how to create revenue off it. It was a free website that people were going to. We're like, what do we put a fucking ad on the front page now? Like, how do you make money? And then as we started to learn about, you know, marketing yourself, monetizing websites, you have t-shirts, you have ways to generate income so that not only can you pay your own bills, but you can grow your business. Right. And once we have basically five people now who are full-time and another 5, 6, 7 that are part-time with us, every day we're thinking of ways to not just extract money from people. That's not what we're trying to do, but better the product so that people want to be a part of our culture and what we're doing. If we do that correctly, then we will have our needs taken care of and the business will grow and the community will grow and we have a mutually beneficial relationship, And we're all very happy with the situation. So a successful business isn't a part-time hobby. A successful business, as I think everyone at this table knows, is your lifestyle. And it's not necessarily first over your relationships, other things in life, but it is as important as what you're doing because business is relationships. That's how you grow it. Form relationships that are as important as anything else.
It's kind of 1A.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, and doing, you know, doing what you love to do and making sure the business makes progress all the time is important for you, your significant others, your family, whoever is around you. It's important that you're taking care of yourself. And so, you know, I think a lot of times it's kind of popular for people to say, well, it's not really about like money. Well, it's always about money because money can help with expansion. And with expansion, that can help with so many other things, and it can help. It could help this podcast. It could help the people listening. The people listening could get more free shit. The more success that this has, or the more success that Slingshot has, and so on. And I think that I think it's okay to be transparent about that.
Yeah, I mean, we don't hide the fact that we monetize our website and that we sell T-shirts. I mean, I think it's pretty clear that people realize for us to be able to dedicate our lives to it, we have to be able to live our lives outside of this website. So money has to come in, and it's the more that we get people involved in it, the more opportunities we have to say, hey, let's have a fucking big retreat down in Florida and invite anyone who wants to show up for free and we'll do stuff. You know, we have all these ideas that we want to generate to better the community. But to do that, everything takes money. Yeah, everything costs money. That's just the way it is.
You need the money to be able to continue to broadcast your message. Really.
Of course. Yeah. I mean, that's what the world runs on, unfortunately.
Exactly.
So
last thing before we drop off, CrossFit Open is here. And what's a message you got for the peeps out there, Drew?
My message, and if you're a MisFit Athletics follower, you've heard this too many times, and I'm never going to stop saying it, do not be afraid to train during the Open. You will be a shell of yourself in weeks 4 and 5, and you will not reach your goal. And it will suck. And
by the way, for the record, I would be a total basket case if I was involved in any of this. I would like redo the workout every day. Yeah. And I'd be fucked up mentally and physically.
We know plenty of people.
You're not alone in that.
Nope, not at all.
I'd be in a wheelchair. That's really what happened.
We do it the second it's announced on Thursday nights, and we have like a little. We do Facebook Live, and we go against each other head to head for because. Who cares? Fun. And then you get it over with and you're like, oh, you motherfuckers have to do this. And I'm like done for the whole week. And it's a great feeling. So that's how awesome. I deal with my stress from the Open.
The demeanor in the whole gym probably changes quite a bit when some people have gone through the workout, right? Like people are probably tense as shit.
And
even the coming days, like everyone's waiting for the announcement. Yeah. And everyone's just got to stick up their ass. But once that's done, then everyone's probably like, hey, like, what are you doing tonight?
Until the next Thursday.
You got another week.
It's a busy 5 weeks for us. There's no doubt about it. It's the entry level to the big show. You know what I mean? It's the entry level. So everyone's participating. Everyone comes out of the woodwork that you may not have even talked to for like 3 months that have followed your program. And all of a sudden,
what do you now?
12 questions for you. It's like, if you don't know, it's too fucking late. Like, we're here. It's time to go.
You can't train for it anymore.
No. I mean, it's here. You waited. You know, you did a couple extra push-ups yesterday, but the workout's tomorrow, so it's on.
I can't improve your miles per gallon if you're at 495 miles to a 500-mile.
Correct. That's it.
Where can people find you guys?
MisFit Athletics on Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, MisFitAthletics.com.
Yeah.
The website.
Bread and butter.
SharpenTheAxeCo.com is our gear.
Yep. Sharpen the Axe on Instagram.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Your IG handle?
Seth UMFer.
MisFit Coach.
MisFit Media Man.
There we go. Awesome. Multiply your hustle, multiply your muscle, and may all your shits be tapered. I'm at Mark Smelly Bell on Instagram and Twitter.
Later. Shout out to all of our sponsors, 8-Man Strong Apparel at 8manstrong.com, bodybuilding.com for all your supplement needs, Compex USA for cutting edge muscle stim machines, increase your bench press at howmuchyoubench.net, Power, the only strength magazine available in both digital and print at thepowermagazine.com. I'm the Jim McD, everywhere that I want you to find me on the social medias. Follow the show on Instagram. We are at Mark Bell's PowerCast.
Almost 1 hour and a half.
Wow. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, guys.
This was awesome.
Great.
A lot of fun.
Hey. Thank you so much.
That was great.
Hit the like button, and we'll be back next week with MisFit Athletics.